The discussion topic of today will be about unqualified audit reports. Basically, we have defined auditing as a process of accumulating and evaluating evidence about financial statement information to determine and report on the degree of correspondence between such information and the set of accounting standards adopted, whether local GAAP or IFRS. So the final stage in the audit process is the preparation of the audit report, which communicates the auditor's findings to interested users who rely on the audit report in reducing the information risk associated with the financial statement and hence to reduce cost of capital. Auditors most frequently report upon a complete set of financial statements, including the balance sheet, the income statement, the owner's equity statement, the statement of cash flows, and related disclosures and footnotes associated with the financial statement. To enable users of the auditor's report to understand its language, the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants professional standards provides uniform wording for the auditor's report. Different auditors may slightly alter the wording or presentation, however, the wording, the meaning will always be the same. The standard unqualified audit report, as you can see, includes 7 parts. Report title, report address, introductory paragraph, scope paragraph, opinion paragraph, name of CPA firm, and report date. So again, to enable users to understand the language of the auditor's report, the professional standards issued by the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants provide uniform wording for the auditor's report. And the standard unqualified audit report contains 7 parts. Report title, report address, introductory paragraph, scope paragraph, opinion paragraph, name of CPA firm, and report date. The first part in the audit report is the report title. The auditing standards require the report to be titled, and an appropriate title would be Independent Auditor's Report. The title must include the word independent to convey to users that the audit was unbiased in all aspects. As mentioned previously, the auditor should maintain high level of independence in his mental attitude. This is to keep confidence of the users who rely on their report. The second part in the auditor's report is the report address. The report is addressed to the company, its stockholders, or the board of directors, and it has become customary to address the report to the board of directors. The first paragraph in the auditor's report is the introductory paragraph, and let's now read the introductory paragraph of the standard unqualified report on comparative statements for a U.S. Public company. We have audited the balance sheets of General Rand Corporation as of December 31, 2011 and 2010, and related statements of income, retained earnings, and cash flows. These financial statements are the responsibility of the company's management. Our responsibility is to express an opinion on these financial statements based on our audit. The first paragraph in the auditor's report makes the simple statement that the certified public accounting firm has done an audit. This is to distinguish the audit report from the review report. It also lists the financial statements that have been audited, including the balance sheet date and accounting periods for income statement and cash flow statement. In addition, the first paragraph states that management is responsible for the preparation and fair presentation of financial statements in accordance with GAAP, and it is the auditor's responsibility to express an opinion on the financial statements based on an audit. So the first paragraph clarifies the respective rules of management and the auditor. Management is responsible for preparing the financial statements in accordance with GAAP. Management is responsible for selecting appropriate accounting principles and making measurement decisions and disclosures in applying those principles. However, it is the auditor's responsibility to express an opinion on the financial statements based on the accumulation and evaluation of evidence about financial statement information. The second paragraph in the standard unqualified audit report is the scope paragraph. Let's now read the scope paragraph of the audit report that we have over here. We conducted our audit in accordance with auditing standards generally accepted in the United States of America. Those standards require that we plan and perform the audit to obtain reasonable assurance about whether the financial statements are free of material misstatements. An audit includes examining on a test basis evidence supporting the amounts and disclosures in the financial statements. An audit also includes assessing the accounting principles used and significant estimates made by management, as well as evaluating the overall financial statement presentation. We believe that our audit provides reasonable basis for our opinion. The scope paragraph is a factual statement about what the auditor did in the audit. It states that the auditor followed generally accepted auditing standards, and if the company is a public company, such standards would be issued by the Public Company Accounting Oversight Board. It states that the audit is designed to obtain reasonable assurance about whether the financial statements are free of material misstatements. And the inclusion of the term material is intended to convey to users that it is the auditor's responsibility to search only for significant misstatements that are likely to mislead users' decision-making process. However, it's not the auditor's responsibility to search for minor misstatements that are not likely to affect users' decisions. The inclusion of the term reasonable assurance is also intended to indicate that an audit can't eliminate the possibility that material misstatements will exist in the financial statements. In other words, an audit process provides high level of assurance, however, it's not a guarantee. The remainder of the scope paragraph discusses the audit evidence accumulated and includes the word test cases. The word test basis is intended to indicate that sampling was used by the auditor rather than examining each single transaction or amount included in the financial statement. Finally, the scope paragraph details the auditor's responsibility, while the introductory paragraph mentioned that it is the auditor's responsibility to express an opinion on the financial statement. The scope paragraph gives more details with respect to the auditor's responsibility. And in specific, it mentions that it is the auditor's responsibility to evaluate whether management used appropriate accounting standards, estimates, and financial statement presentations and disclosures. The final paragraph in the standard unqualified audit report is the opinion paragraph. Let's read the opinion paragraph of the report that we have. In our opinion, the financial statements referred to above present fairly in all material respects the financial position of General Rank Corporation and the results of its operations and its cash flows for the years then ended in conformity with accounting principles generally accepted in the United States of America. The final paragraph in the auditor's report is the opinion paragraph. It communicates the auditor's findings based on the results of the audit. It is expressed as an opinion rather than a statement of absolute fact or guarantee. The term in our opinion is intended to indicate that there may be some information rest still associated with the financial statement despite the performance of complete audit with satisfactory results. The auditor's opinion is based on professional judgment and they don't guarantee or certify that the statements are accurate. The term present fairly means that gaps are followed. And it's very important also to recognize that it is the auditor's responsibility to look beyond gaps. It is the auditor's responsibility to discover any material information misstatements that are likely to mislead users' decisions. The name of CPA firm is mentioned after the opinion paragraph. It identifies the certified public accounting firm who performed the audit. Then report date is mentioned, and the appropriate date is the one on which the auditor completing the auditing procedures in the field. What are the conditions required to issue the standard unqualified audit report? The standard unqualified audit report is issued when all the statements are included, including income statements, balance sheets, owner's equity statements, and cash flow statements. When sufficient evidence has been accumulated, there is no scope restriction. Management provided the auditor all the information and explanation that he deemed necessary for the completion of the audit. When the financial statements are fairly stated in accordance with GAAP, there is no GAAP violation, no information misstatement, sufficient and informative disclosures have been included in the financial statements footnotes. And finally, there is no circumstances requiring the addition of an explanatory paragraph after the opinion paragraph. By the beginning of 2000, high-profile accounting scandals took place in the USA with the internet bubble crash, including the collapse of US companies like Enron and Qualcomm. This is due to overstated profits and earnings management practices. Such era is also marked by the fall of audit firm that audited Enron's financial statements. Following such economic crisis at the beginning of 2000, the U.S. government stepped in through the enactment of the Sarbanes-Oxley Act of 2002. The act is intended to increase corporate governance quality, to reduce earnings management practices, and to increase the quality of accounting information provided to interested users. The improvement established by the Sarbanes-Oxley Act of 2002 required the auditor of a public company to attest to management reports on the effectiveness of internal control over financial reporting. So the Sarbanes-Oxley Act issued by the U.S. Congress in 2002 as a reaction to the economic crisis that took place by the beginning of 2000 required management of corporations listed in the U.S. capital market to report on the effectiveness of its internal control over financial reporting, and requires a public company to attest to management's report. In this context, the auditor may choose to issue separate reports on internal control over financial reporting or to issue a combined report on both financial statements and internal control over financial reporting. In some cases, the auditor performed a complete audit with satisfactory results and concluded that the financial statements are fairly stated, but he believes it's important to provide additional information. That's why an explanatory paragraph is added after the opinion paragraph. And this takes place in case of lack of consistent application of GAAP, when the auditor has substantial doubt about the entity's ability to continue its operations as going concern, and when the auditor would like to emphasize on a matter. The first condition under which an explanatory paragraph is added after the opinion paragraph is lack of consistent application of GAAP. Basically, GAAP requires that a change in accounting principle to be to applicable principle, and that the nature and impact of such change be properly disclosed in the financial statement footnote. It is the auditor's responsibility to make sure that the newly adopted principle is GAAP. The company has justified that the alternative principle is preferable. Disclosures related to the change are sufficient and informative. Comparability between financial statements across accounting periods haven't been significantly affected. And finally, the auditor should make sure that accounting estimate affected by the change in the accounting principle doesn't indicate management engagement in earnings management. With respect to the final point, it's important to clarify that the company may switch from one accounting method to another to generate higher earnings in the short term to mask the poor economic performance of the firm. By doing so, the management is engaging in earnings manipulation behavior. For instance, the company may switch from LIFO, locked-in, first-out inventory valuation technique, to FIFO, first-in, first-out, to increase reported earnings in the short term. In the same manner, the firm may change from accelerated to straight-line depreciation method to push earnings up in the short term, masking the poor economic performance of the firm. So, in this context, management is exploiting the accounting choice to manipulate earnings. So, it is the auditor's responsibility to make sure that the accounting estimate affected by the change in the accounting principle doesn't indicate management engagement in earnings manipulation behavior. An explanatory paragraph should be added after the opinion paragraph when the auditor has a potential doubt about the entity's ability to continue its operations as going concern or to meet its obligations. And this takes place when the company has significant recurring operating losses or working capital deficiencies, when the company is unable to obey its obligations when it comes due, when the company lose major customer, or when the company has legal proceedings that might prevent it from continue its operations, and so on. In some cases, the auditor adds an explanatory paragraph to emphasize on a matter, such as the existence of significant related party transactions. Transaction between parent and subsidiary is an example. When there is important events that take place after the balance sheet date, when the auditor would like to describe accounting matter affecting the comparability between financial statements other than those related to changing the accounting principles, such as new investments in research and development, sale of subsidiary, variation in format and presentation of financial statements. That's it for today, and I would like to thank you so much for listening.